Present in the room are the following WHO expert. We start with Dr. Tedros Adhanom Ghebreyesus, who is the WHO Director General, Dr. Mike Ryan, Executive Director, Health Emergency Program, Dr. Maria von Kerkhove, Technical Lead for COVID-19, Dr. Kate O'Brien, Director, Immunization, Vaccines and Biologicals, Mr. Steve Solomon, who is the Principal Legal Officer, and we have also Dr. Sylvie Briand, Director, Epidemic, Pandemic Preparedness and Prevention, Dr. Silberschmidt-Gaudens, who is Director, Health and Multilateral Partnerships, and Dr. Abdi Mahamoud, Director, Ad Interim for Alert and Response Coordination Department. We have also Dr. Jaouad Mahjour, who is Assistant Director General for Emergency and Preparedness, and also Dr. Rogerio, who is Director in the Department of Prequalification. I think that I mentioned all our experts. I have some difficulties seeing everyone, but before we start, I would like to invite the president of ACANU, Tamer Aboalenin, to say a few words before giving the floor to Dr. Tedros. Tamer, you have the floor.
Shukran, Fadila. Thank you, Dr. Tedros, indeed, for hosting us and accepting our invitation to this press conference. We appreciate that you are the first and only Director General of an international organization who committed to make an annual meeting with our members on a regular basis, end of the year conference. Thank you for that. We realize that times are not always available, especially during crisis, but when the opportunity arose, you didn't hesitate to meet us again in person. A few days ago, I was reading a book about medicine and philosophy, and then I came across Avicenna's Ibn Sina saying, "There are no incurable diseases, only the lack of will. There are no worthless herbs, only the lack of knowledge." I remembered you immediately. I don't know why. Your image came in my mind immediately. Maybe perhaps because you give us the impression that you believe in this. Thank you again, and thanks again for you, Fadila, and all the media team for organizing it. And now we all are ears.
Thank you so much, Tamer. Dr. Tedros, you have the floor.
Thank you. Thank you, Tamer, for that very kind introduction and for the very, very kind words. And I think this is one of the few moments we say good afternoon only, because you're all in-house. Good afternoon and a very warm welcome to our friends from ACANU and the Geneva Press Corps as we approach the end of 2022. The past year has been another very challenging year for the health of the world's people. 1 year ago, Omicron had just been identified and was starting to take off. At that time, COVID-19 was killing 50,000 people each week. Last week, less than 10,000 people lost their lives. That's still 10,000 too many. And there is still a lot that all countries can do to save lives. But we have come a long way. We're hopeful that at some point next year, we will be able to say that COVID-19 is no longer a global health emergency. The criteria for declaring an end to the emergency will be among the topics of conversation when the emergency committee meets in January. Of course, this virus will not go away. It's here to stay. And all countries will need to learn to manage it alongside other respiratory illnesses, including influenza and RSV, both of which are now circulating intensely in many countries. However, we still face many uncertainties and challenges in 2023. Only one in five people in low-income countries has been vaccinated. Access to diagnostics and life-saving treatments for COVID-19 remains unacceptably unaffordable and unequal. The burden of post-COVID-19 condition is only likely to increase, and large gaps in surveillance remain, which is a weakness not only for defeating new variants of COVID-19, but also for monitoring the spread of other infections. As we look to end this emergency, we still need to understand how it began. We continue to call on China to share the data and conduct the studies that we have requested to better understand the origins of this virus. As I have said many times, all hypotheses remain on the table. One of the most important lessons of the pandemic is that all countries need to strengthen their public health systems to prepare for, prevent, detect, and respond rapidly to outbreaks, epidemics, and pandemics. An advanced medical care system is not the same thing as a strong public health system. One of the other key lessons of the pandemic is the need for much stronger cooperation and collaboration, rather than the competition and confusion that marked the global response to COVID-19. So I'm very pleased that last week WHO's member states agreed to develop the first draft of a legally binding accord on pandemic prevention, preparedness and response based on the principles of equity, solidarity, and sovereignty. Member states will begin discussing this zero draft of the pandemic accord in February. Even as the COVID-19 pandemic improved during the course of the year, we were confronted with many other emergencies. As we speak, WHO is responding to 53 graded emergencies, and in the past year, we have responded to more than 200 outbreaks. The global outbreak of mpox, a disease that was mostly unknown outside Africa, took the world by surprise. More than 82,000 cases have been reported from 110 countries, although the mortality rate has remained low with 65 deaths. Thankfully, the number of weekly reported cases has declined more than 90% since I declared a public health emergency of international concern in July. If the current trend continues, we are hopeful that next year we will also be able to declare an end to this emergency. Likewise, with no new cases in more than 2 weeks and no patients being treated at the moment, the countdown to the end of Ebola outbreak in Uganda has begun. If no new cases are detected, the outbreak will be declared over on the 10th of January. With support from WHO and partners, the government of Uganda is now focusing its efforts on surveillance and monitoring the last few contacts under follow-up. Last week, the first batch of candidate vaccines arrived in Uganda within 80 days of the declaration of the outbreak, faster than for any previous outbreak. This was thanks to a remarkable collaboration of partners around the world who have worked together to advance candidate vaccines and ensure their availability to carry out trials. So we end a difficult year with some encouraging news. COVID-19, mpox, and Ebola are all declining. However, there are many other crises to which WHO is responding. In the Greater Horn of Africa, severe drought is driving an acute health and hunger crisis. 47 million people are now facing hunger in the region, and disease outbreaks are surging. WHO and our partners are on the ground, ensuring access to basic health services, providing treatment for severe malnutrition, and helping countries to prevent, detect, and respond to outbreaks. Meanwhile, we're continuing to respond to cholera outbreaks in 29 countries, including Haiti, which has more than 1,200 confirmed cases, more than 14,000 suspected cases, and 280 reported deaths after more than 3 years without a case of cholera. This week, Haiti received almost 1.2 million doses of oral cholera vaccines, and vaccination campaigns are expected to start in the coming days in the most affected areas. WHO PAHO has also supplied almost 50 tons of essential medical supplies to cholera treatment centers. Outbreaks, wars, and other humanitarian emergencies make the headlines, but the health of the world's people continues to be under threat from many causes that don't make the news as often. Tobacco use, while declining globally, still kills more than 8 million people a year. Unhealthy diets are driving increasing rates of obesity, diabetes, cancer, cardiovascular disease, and more. Progress against HIV, malaria, and TB has stalled or gone backwards. Only half the world's population can access safe sanitation services. The pandemic has exposed and exacerbated the huge unmet burden in mental health. Hundreds of millions of people either can't access or afford essential health services. And the global addiction to fossil fuels poisons the air we breathe and makes the planet on which all life depends less habitable. As we look ahead to 2023, there are many reasons for hope and many reasons for concern. WHO remains as committed as ever to supporting our member states to build a healthier, safer, and fairer future for the world's people. Fadila, back to you. And thank you so much again for joining us.
Thank you, Dr. Tedros. I will move a little bit in the room to be able to see everyone, but let's get started with Christian Ulrich from DPA. Christian.
Hello, Dr. Tedros. Christiana with the German Press Agency. You touched upon COVID and your hope that the fake might be finished sometime next year. Now, we all know that you are following the guidance of the committee, so it's not a WHO decision on its own. You are waiting for that. But can you give us some broad strokes of what you think the world should look like so that the committee can recommend this fake should be finished? Thank you.
Thanks. Thanks very much for the question. And first of all, it's really lovely to see all of you here in the room. I'm reflecting back on the time when we were all sitting in lower shock answering those questions in the early days. Your question is poignant. So the emergency committee will be discussing many things about COVID-19, and in particular, looking at the considerations for recommending to the Director General that the public health of emergency of international concern is over. But that decision rests with the Director General. They will make advice according to the international health regulations, but that decision remains with the DG. There are a lot of factors that they're looking at. You know, one, for example, the epidemiology, what's actually happening, you know, globally with the virus itself and its circulation, the variants, the changes in the virus. What can we expect? What do we know will happen? What is uncertain as it will happen? And very importantly, the impact. So what we're more looking at right now is while we continue to expect there to be cases and waves of infection and reinfection around the world, the impact of COVID-19 does not need to be what it was in the beginning, and it is not what it was in the beginning. We continue to see this decoupling of cases and hospitalizations and deaths. Hospitalizations and deaths are much lower than they've ever been. Although you did hear the DG say, we still see between 8 and 10,000 deaths reported each week. These deaths are largely happening among people who are not vaccinated or haven't received the full number of doses that are recommended for them. So we feel there's much more work to be done. So the emergency committee will be looking at the impact of the virus in various settings, in the context of other circulating pathogens, in the context of war, in the context of other crises that they're facing, droughts, floods, et cetera. And they're looking at capacities to respond. How are countries faring in dealing with COVID-19? How are they able to adjust their strategies to manage COVID as a disease? in terms of reducing that impact, reducing morbidity and mortality, and the need for a coordinated global response. We'll remind you that among the vaccination, although vaccination has improved around the world, approximately 30% of the world has not yet received a single dose of vaccine. And the targets that the DG and partners have set of reaching 70% of the world's population, and within that 100% of people who are at risk of developing severe disease, the older age groups, people with immunocompromised, people with underlying conditions, our frontline workers of 100%, those targets have not been met. So there's a lot more work to be done. So we, as the Secretariat, will provide as much information as we can to the Emergency Committee to look at burden, to look at impact, to be able to assess the variance and the uncertainty of that, to look at the capacities to respond so that they can have their deliberations to make their recommendation to the DG. But from our point of view, there is much more work to be done, as the DG has said, because each life is precious. And we feel that the tools that exist for COVID-19 to get patients into that clinical care pathway, to use antivirals appropriately, to use vaccination strategically and ensuring those who are most at risk are actually vaccinated, there's more work to be done.
Thank you, Dr. Mike Ryan.
Thanks, Maria. It's actually nice to be not looking into that, but looking at a real human being. So that's fantastic. In addition to the epidemiologic factors and the impact factors, the protection factors, when you look at any disease, that's whether you consider it to be of more importance than others. And Tedros spoke to the fact that there are lots of diseases, there are lots of conditions for which health systems are struggling to cope with. You look at that both in terms of the absolute impact of that disease. You look at it in terms of what might happen. How certain are you of what the changes might be? So there's an issue of unpredictability. We might look at cancer numbers or an endemic disease, and we know what those numbers are year to year. We still don't know everything about this virus. We still don't know how this virus will evolve in future. So there are uncertainties that add to the risk. And the more the risk increases in your mind, the uncertainty increases, the more you have to have contingencies to be reactive and have that capacity to respond. There are also those vulnerabilities in the system. Have we shut down those vulnerabilities by protecting the most vulnerable in our society? Because the virus can do what it likes. If we're fully protected, then the virus can go about its business. In the context of fully vaccinated populations against measles, the measles virus is not a problem. The measles virus is only a problem when people are not vaccinated against it. And I think it's pretty much the same in the case of COVID. The other factor, and Sylvie might speak to this later, is the level to which we've integrated our COVID activities into the normal health system programming. So is the surveillance for COVID integrated with respiratory virus surveillance? Are the clinical pathways, our vaccination for COVID integrated into our vaccination with flu and other adult vaccinations like hepatitis, for example? Have we integrated the clinical care pathways? So someone presenting in a general practice or in a primary healthcare setting has been diagnosed for respiratory disease, not for COVID, where the frontline worker has access to rapid diagnostics and a laboratory test. Have the pathways in the hospital been integrated so that when you have severe respiratory disease, you don't see the COVID doctor, you don't see the flu doctor, you see the respiratory physician who treats your disease regardless of what it is. So there is an element to move away from an emergency and you want to normalize the situation, that's what you're saying, then you have to have a normal system that can cope. There's no point putting the responsibility for COVID back into the regular system completely if that system is not going to be able to cope. So there's so many different factors you have to consider. The pandemic virus won't disappear. The history of pandemics is that pandemic virus generally remains until it's replaced by the next pandemic virus. The most common cause of flu since the last pandemic has been the pandemic strain of the virus, H1N1. So the virus will not disappear. The virus will likely remain a global phenomenon, though it may be present at lower or higher numbers, depending on seasonal, geographic, and migration and population mixing factors. The question is, and the question that Dr. Tedros will ask the committee to advise him on, is to whether the actual event associated with the virus still constitutes a public health emergency of international concern. Are there unusual features still? Will there be an unusual variant or a new variant emerging? Does the virus require a comprehensive, coordinated global response? Well, if we've as the DG has said, if there are huge chunks of the population that have still don't have access to vaccine, I think the world still has a job of work to do. The job is not done. So it's not just the virus issues that matter, it's the response and the coordination and the need for that coordinated response. So Dr. Tedros has a balance to strike here between the virus, its impact, its unpredictability, and whether or not we have dealt with the vulnerabilities and the resilience issues in our health systems so we can cope. He must keep the alert high when so many people in the world don't have access to vaccines, when so many health systems are very weakened at the moment and are struggling to cope even with their winter load of respiratory viruses. So I do think the committee will meet informally to consider some of the criteria they're looking at. They will then meet formally in the new year. They will look at whether it's time to consider that process or to consider that decision, and they'll advise the DG accordingly. And I think that's why Tedros has said sometime next year, because I believe he's a man who's not going to try and, he may hope for the best, but he's certainly not going to try and predict the future in the heart of the winter season, where this virus is really, in many countries, still spreading pretty much out of control, while thankfully, because of the protection offered by vaccines, less and less people are dying. But every death is a tragedy, and most of those deaths are preventable. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Ryan. Let's go to
Stefan Bussard, Le Temps newspaper. Thank you for holding this briefing. You were talking about a possible decision on fake next year. As you know, in China, there's an explosion of COVID-19 cases because of the easing of the zero COVID policy. So I was wondering, how do you react to what's going on in China now? And how do you see the risk of COVID-19 spreading all around the area? Thank you.
Maria will address the technical aspects of your question, but I think what's not clear, and you mentioned it because I just want to check on the logic here. The explosion of cases in China is not due to the lifting of COVID restrictions. The explosion of cases in China had started long before any easing of the zero COVID policy. And I think it's very important to recognize that and we've all learned this around the world, the super transmissibility of Omicron really took away the opportunity for using public health social measures and policies aimed at full containment of the virus. And I think the world has recognized that the use of public health and social measures over the last year has been primarily to keep the pressure off the health system while you get vaccination levels to the highest level possible. So the use of public health and social measures has changed dynamically over the course of the epidemic. When we didn't have vaccines, public health and social measures were exceptionally important because they really kept people, especially the most vulnerable, safe from the virus and allowed people to get higher standards of care. As vaccines came on stream, we started to have opportunities to provide more protections, particularly to the vulnerable. But at the same time, as vaccines came on stream, we started to see the emergence of significant variants that had both the capacity to spread more easily, thankfully not be more severe, but did show signs of vaccine escape if, for example, people didn't have a full course, if there was a long time between their last vaccine, especially in older and vulnerable people, more than 6 months since your last vaccine. We could see in the data, someone, maybe Kate and Anna Maria and others will speak to this, but we see that falling away of full protection against that. What is clear is that a full course of the available vaccines, particularly with a booster in the case of older persons or vulnerable people, provides a very high level of protection from hospitalization and death. And there is data from places like Hong Kong that show that the inactivated Chinese vaccines with the addition of a third dose performed very, very well and in comparison as well. But it did require that third dose to show that effect. But also, like all vaccines, there's a waning immunity. So it doesn't really matter what your vaccination level is. There's also, and again, I'll ask Kate and others to come in, it's who you vaccinated, how many times did you vaccinate them, when did you last vaccinate them, and increasingly will be, which is becoming into the picture, is which combination of antigens are you using in the vaccine, right? And so all those questions become relevant. But I do think, because there's a little narrative at the moment that in some way China lifted the restrictions and all of a sudden the disease is out of control. The disease was spreading intensively because I believe the control measures in themselves were not stopping the disease. And I believe that the Chinese authorities have decided strategically that that for them is not the best option anymore. And that they need to, and I hope they will, and I hope this is the case, will refocus on the other part of the strategy, is to use public health and social measures for what they're supposed to be used for, which is to release pressure off the health system, but not putting too much pressure, as Dr. Tedros said in his speech, on the social and the livelihoods and the economic side of things. You have to balance the public health and social measures for their public health benefit versus the price you pay socially and economically. But you do that while at the same time rapidly increasing your vaccination levels across the population and especially in vulnerable groups. So the question, I think, and the challenge that China and other countries still have is, are the people that need to be vaccinated adequately vaccinated with the right vaccine and the right number of doses? And when was the last time those people had a vaccine? I sound like I'm being very simplistic here, but you know, sometimes public health and epidemiology is very easy to explain, but it's really hard to do. It's really hard to deliver that. Saying that sounds easy, but actually delivering on that is a very difficult thing to do. So shifting and the difficult thing in public health is to be able to shift gears, be able to play the game that's in front of you, not the game you were playing yesterday. Is to play the team that you're playing right now, not the one you expected to be on the pitch. And I think it's very important that we look to what the virus is doing and then what the tools we now have and mix those tools in a way, stops the virus when you can and when you need to protect vulnerable people, protect the health system, vaccinate those that you need to vaccinate, maintain surveillance so you know what the hell is going on. And if you can do those three things, you get to live with this virus. And I think countries like China and others are going through this period now in the winter where there's more pressure. We don't have as good a surveillance. And countries are having to make, I hope, what are sound strategic choices and commit to those choices. But I just don't think it helps if we say the explosion of cases is because China lifted the restrictions. I think the increased intensity of transmission was occurring long before there was any change in the policy. Priya, sorry.
Yeah, thank you. So I think exactly that. It's to come back to the fundamentals. It's coming back to the fundamentals of we know what works, and it's applying those all of those different types of interventions appropriately for that population. So within China and elsewhere, we have to utilize these tools most effectively. So it is about using testing appropriately, getting patients into that clinical care pathway, having access to antivirals so that those who do get infected don't progress to severe disease or require hospitalization, advance to severe disease and burden the healthcare system. We certainly expect that there will be cases that will increase, but we can prevent those cases from becoming severe. It's about ensuring that patients or people who are infected do isolate. And what we are seeing is that people around the world who are infected are isolating at home. Their family members or those close contacts are staying home if they're unwell. And so that works in terms of preventing onward transmission. These are the fundamentals. We can't find all cases or stop all transmissions. That's not the goal. But we can take the pressure off the circulation of this virus and the pressure off this virus to continue to change. It's to ensure that vaccination is reaching those who are most at risk. And as Mike has said, to make sure that those who are over 60, those who are have underlying conditions, those who are immunocompromised, our frontline workers, receive the full course of vaccination according to the schedule that they need. It's not just about if you got one dose or two doses, making sure that you receive that full that full course. And that's what needs to increase in China, but also elsewhere. In every country of the world, we're missing critical people who are in vulnerable categories who have not received the full course of vaccination. And this is a key message we have right now to end this emergency, to take the death and devastation out of COVID, which we are seeing around the world. We have to continue on this target. This is absolutely fundamental. And it's never too late to up your vaccination. I think that's another thing we need to get across there. It is wonderful that we have so many safe and effective vaccines, but the job is not over. We're 3 years in. We're starting the fourth year of this pandemic, and the virus is here to stay. We will need to continue to use vaccination as part of this strategy, in addition to other measures. And the last thing I just want to mention is two things. The public health and social measures aren't as effective as they were with Omicron, because Omicron is so unbelievably transmissible. But we continue to advise masking. You see people in this room that are wearing masks. We continue to advise improving ventilation where we live, where we work, where we study. These are things that need to continue, and using them in a rational way will help take the pressure off this virus. And we need to communicate and listen. This is very difficult. This virus will be here with us to stay. We're still learning about it. We don't know for certain how it will unfold, although we see very good signs that the impact is reducing. But we have to remain humble to this. We don't know everything. And so we have to watch, we have to study, we have to have scientists have the space to do the work that they need to advise us so that we can make the appropriate decisions. And we have to listen to our communities. We have to listen to how the recommendations that are suggested, how we implement these policies, listen to them and have them be part of the solution. And this is something that will never go away, regardless of if it's COVID or we talk about other pathogens. So a lot more work to do. So please, you know, around the world, governments, we're working with governments to integrate COVID into a longer term disease control program to make sure that we're dealing with COVID in the context of everything else, increase that vaccination coverage, particularly among those who are most at risk. This is really key going forward.
Thank you. I think, Dr.
I can add a bit, because when they come ACANU, they may expect me also to, although my colleagues are finishing almost everything. First of all, I think we have come a long way. And the situation now is significantly better. That's why the world is opening up. And the second is, you know, although we're opening up and we're much better, but the virus is here to stay. It will stay with us. It was a guest, now it's almost part of the family. So the key is, how do we manage this virus? And managing this virus, I think we're in a better situation because we know the virus better. And second, we have the tools, whether it's vaccines or treatments. But more importantly, we have now what you call population immunity, whether it's through natural infection or vaccines. As my colleague said, especially with Omicron, it was moving fast, and the population immunity is high in any country you name. So going forward, especially with FIC, declaration of FIC to lift that, I believe it's in our hands, because it's a matter of really making sure that especially the at-risk group is protected, especially the elderly and other vulnerable groups. Even when we talk about China, the same. If they could focus on the at-risk groups, as we know, the elderly, especially above 80 years old, the vaccination coverage is low. I think it's around 60%. If that could improve, if they work with speed and scale, I think, especially on vaccination, that could help them to manage. But especially for China, I think, where it's different from now from the rest of the world in terms of all the factors that I have said earlier, I think the speed and scale, but at the same time targeted on the at-risk group, will be very important. But given all the things that my colleagues said, I think we're better off next year. And, you know, with the interventions, of course, that we hope will continue, we will be able to lift the FIC. Of course, the emergency committee normally recommends to WHO, and it will be up to us to decide what to do. But of course, it will be based on the situation on the ground. Thank you, and back to you, Fadila.
Thank you, Dr. Tedros. Please raise your hand. I noted Catherine, then Paula and Emma, and I will come back to the others. Thank you, Catherine.
Thank you, Fadila. Catherine Fiancombo-Conga here. My question is a follow-up about what Dr. von Kerkhove said, and Mike and Dr. Tedros, about using vaccination as part of the strategy. And I would like to know if you think that vaccination should be mandatory for children, for instance, for going to attend schools like certain other like measles or things like that, and also what kind of vaccines, because if I'm not wrong, Sputnik has not been validated yet by WHO, and we know that some people in the world have used Sputnik because they could not receive the vaccines that were in fact on the WHO list. So how would you Would you like to handle that? And also about the experts that are working on new vaccines because of the new variants. So thank you.
Thank you, Catherine. Dr. Who will answer your question.
So thanks for the questions. There were three of them. I know we normally have a one question, but this is obviously a special environment. The first is, I think we just want to return to sort of the performance of the vaccines. What's really important to remember is that we had great hope that the vaccines would not only protect against significant disease, hospitalization, and death, but that they would have a significant impact on the risk of getting infected and a significant impact on the transmission from one person to the next. But these strains of COVID virus, SARS-CoV-2 virus, and these vaccines, in fact, don't have that level of performance against infection and transmission that we certainly had hoped that they would at the beginning when the vaccines were being developed. And we've known that for a long time. As Mike said, as Maria said, these vaccines work really well against protection against hospitalization, against death, against severe disease. And they have some impact on infection, but it is not long-lived. And as a result, there's not much impact on protecting people from transmitting from one person to the next. So the question of whether or not children should be vaccinated is really a decision that is firmly at the national level. There are benefits to vaccinating. These vaccines are safe in children. They do have effectiveness. But just as in adults, the benefit of these vaccines is largely about protecting against disease. It's not about protecting for any durable period of time against infection or reducing transmission. With respect to the question of mandatory vaccines, this is not a question that's unique to COVID vaccines. And certainly the position of WHO is that it is always better to have programs where information about vaccines and the value of vaccines is provided so that community members, families, adults are able to make the best decision about the value of those vaccines and would seek those vaccines. There are some specific circumstances where there is a need for more clear recommendations or even requirements for vaccination. And we've been specific about what the nature of those conditions would have to be in several documents and papers that we've issued. And those are really issues around ethics, around access to vaccine, around decision-making, around autonomy. The vaccines that are available, and there are many vaccines, as you well know, and they are of different platforms, and all of them are providing protection at that disease end of the spectrum. Those manufacturers who have submitted for emergency use listing have had data reviewed, and we continue to review data on emergency use listing and engagement with manufacturers also to move those vaccines into a more regularized regulatory review process. I think what is really important here is that we've also called for ongoing research and development. And the reason for that in our strategy, which is the second goal of the global strategy, is that we don't have optimal vaccines yet. And this is true, this is not unique to COVID vaccines. This is true of virtually every vaccine that is developed, is there is an optimization process. And in particular, we would love to have vaccines that are more effective against infection, that are more effective against transmission, and that have greater duration of protection. And so we really are calling for ongoing investments in research and the development of these vaccines, because as the DG has said, this virus is here with us. It's moved in. It's not just a visitor anymore. And we're going to have this virus with us for the foreseeable future. So we do need an ongoing research program that can advance vaccines to second, third generation, and we hope have greater impact, greater durability, broader impact, and impact against that more mild end of the disease spectrum to be able to protect a greater fraction of the population. And I'll just end by saying that I can't overemphasize enough the importance of those who are most at risk of being fully vaccinated, and that includes booster doses. And with these variants, it's we have seen the clear evidence that the need to have a booster dose in order to get the optimum impact of the vaccines that we have. And so this is an issue across countries where people have vaccine fatigue, and the levels of booster doses are not at the point where we would say countries have achieved that optimum protection. So this, again, especially as in the Northern Hemisphere, we're going into winter seasons, is extremely important for optimizing the performance of those vaccines. Thanks a lot.
Fidela, maybe I could just add, because it's important to that WHO will continue to track this. And we have in place, through the work of IVB, the work that Sylvie's team leads in epidemic and epidemic and pandemic prevention, our tag for virus evolution. We have our tag COVAC, which is monitoring vaccine composition. We have SAGE, which is looking at vaccine policy. So WHO has the machinery to monitor this, to ensure that the world has the best information on evolution, the best information on composition, the best information on policy. So we will be able to keep up, I hope. Maria has said, though, if we don't keep up with the surveillance and the genetic surveillance in particular, we may lose that capacity, because at the moment, the signals we're picking up are easy to pick up and characterize in countries that retain good surveillance. But are we going to rely on only detecting the fire when the only house on the street has already burned down? When the only house with the fire smoke detector is only one, if there's only one house on the street, sorry, with a smoke detector. And it's a little bit like that now for the world. We need to be quick at characterizing any shift in the virus, any shift in its behavior, any vaccine escape, so we can rapidly change vaccine composition, change vaccine policy. But if we're going to be months behind in making that decision, because we've left blind spots on surveillance in different parts of the world, it does come back to that analogy. It's trying to prevent a fire in a community by putting a smoke detector in only one house, or putting 100 smoke detectors in one house and no smoke detectors in the other house. And that's what we do when we increase the intensity of surveillance and genomics in one country, industrialized country, and we can triple, quadruple, we can go up 100-fold in our surveillance capacities in an industrialized country. But you leave a gap in the south, you leave a country with a large population that moves a lot without surveillance, then the problem is that gap is not just going to affect that country. That gap is going to affect the whole world's capacity to react to a new signal. And that's the situation we're in right now. And it's a very hard thing to say, effectively, 3 years into a pandemic, that there are still significant gaps. In fact, many countries have disinvested in surveillance, disinvested in their genomic capacity, because their health systems are under such pressure because of the lives and livelihood and the energy crisis and the economic crisis, that governments are struggling. And many of the systems that we've established are actually, in some countries, been dismantled. That's the world we're in right now. So I think we need to be really careful. If we do want to track and we do want to match our vaccines to the circulating strains, then we still have work to do. And it's not just on vaccine development. It's not losing sight in surveillance. But there is hope. I mean, certainly, Anna Maria may wish to speak to the prospects of aerosol vaccines or vaccines that are not given by injectables, but there is a prospect and there are some really good candidates out there. And WHO, I hope, will be in a position to work with countries and developers in the coming weeks and months to see if we can't advance the development and testing of vaccines that might actually do what Kate needs, is to go beyond just protecting against disease, but actually start interfering with the transmission.
I think Dr. Rogerio would like to answer the question about Sputnik.
Yes, a specific question needs a specific answer. Also, just to remember all that we had a rolling submission from Sputnik on the spring 2021. As a consequence of that, there were a number of inspections by WHO and by WHO with the European Medicines Agency. In the sequence of those inspections, we issued a notice of concern on the GMPs in June 2021. At that moment in time, we didn't have any file. Just to be very clear, the first moment that the file was completely submitted to WHO was 31st of January 2022. And at that moment, we had prepared the two inspections on the drug substance and finished product manufacturing site, and also on the Gamaleya Institute, where the batches for the clinical trials were previously manufactured. Those inspections were scheduled for the first week of March this year and were postponed because of a negative security clearance issued by UNDSS for our inspectors. As a consequence of that, we have been working with the applicant about other opportunities. The applicant has also requested postponements on those inspections. And I can tell you, and this is really as it goes, that we are waiting until closing of business today for the confirmation or not of the dates proposed by the applicant for the first 3 months of next year. If that date is confirmed by today, we can put it on our inspection plan and going through the UNDSS clearance process. If it's not confirmed by today, it needs to go back on track on the planning, because we have a lot of inspections to perform, of course, and we cannot block forever those dates. Thank you.
I think I would like to give the floor to Emma Reuters, and then Paula, Laurent, and John.
Thanks so much. Good afternoon. A question on China and how the WHO can help. I'm wondering how closely you're working with them and what help you're providing, whether it be technical advice or ACT Day. And is China wanting your help? Thank you.
So thanks for the question. I'll take that. So we are helping China as we help all of our member states. So we provide technical support, technical advice through our here at all three levels of the organization, here in headquarters, at their regional office in Wipro, but also in the country office. There are regular interactions, regular meetings with the ministry and other ministries across the house to offer that support and how to adjust the strategy going forward. That help has been since day one and hasn't stopped throughout, and we will continue to do so. In addition to supporting the use of the different tools that are available, access to those tools, support from other countries, whether this is vaccines or whether this is personal protective equipment or whatnot, whatever a member state needs, this is what WHO is here for, and we will continue to do that until this pandemic is over.
I think that's very true, and there's some really practical ongoing engagements with colleagues in China. I know DG, you've spoken with the ambassador recently. We speak with the health attaches. We have various calls on technical matters all the time, and very much an open channel, like we have with all our member states here in Geneva. So I'd like to thank our colleagues at the mission here, the Chinese mission, because they've always been very open to engagement. And we have specific discussions ongoing potentially around vaccine trials, aerosol vaccines, various other things. So I think at the technical level and at the level of science, the Chinese scientists are very interested in engaging. They're very qualified. They're as good, if not better, than many in the world. So I think there's an appetite for that technical and operational and scientific engagement. And I think that's very important to recognize. The issues then around origins investigations, the issues around strategic choices, they're not decisions made by scientists. They're not decisions made by public health officials. They're more made at the strategic and political level. And that's well beyond my pay grade in terms of trying to engage at that level. Dr. Tedros has on multiple occasions publicly spoken about our frustrations around origins investigations and studies, has written multiple times and engaged multiple times directly with counterparts in China. Our only objective in this is to understand the public health truth and the public health origin, the actual origins of this virus, so we can learn lessons for the future. That's why we need to understand that. But we also have to recognize in this, and you know, this is a very politicized issue. And I have to say, and I say it, I know your role and your job in the media is to do your jobs, but this becomes a political football too. And scientific institutions like ourselves struggle at times to understand some of the motivation around this. My motivation, the motivation of the Director General of all of these teams here, is that 1 in 7 people on this planet live in China. If we apply certain standards or measures of to every country in the world, there'll be a hell of a lot of countries we wouldn't be able to work with. If we start to apply moral principles to our engagement, there is an ethical basis to our engagement with countries, but we have to work with many, many people. We're operating with UNICEF 2,500 health facilities in Afghanistan, trying to ensure that 25,000 health workers, 7,500 of whom are women, are still in the healthcare system, still getting paid, and 98% of those women are still attending work. To do that, you have to engage. You don't have a choice. If you want to achieve public health, if you want to deliver life-saving interventions, if you want to make a difference, and you do that all your time in your media life, you've got to engage. And you've got to deliver on that engagement. And sometimes that means that you have to find ways of working, even though on certain aspects of your relationship, you're very frustrated. In certain aspects of your relationship, you're not making progress. But if you do that and then you turn around and don't engage on the scientific level, if you don't engage when you have an opportunity to save lives, then what you're doing is trading off one set of compliance or one set of partnerships, saying, well, we're not going to engage with you on developing a new vaccine or engage with you on helping you with your strategy because you're not cooperating with us on the origins. It's not a zero-sum game. And that's very tough. And I think this is the same journalists face every day too, at what level you have to engage to get the information you need to tell the story you need to tell. That's part of the job. You don't apply a moral judgment to that. You have ethics, but you don't trade those two things off. So I'm sorry to speak about it, but I think it's very important that people understand where WHO is in this and what our primary motivation is in engaging with all our member states, and the balance that Dr. Tedros has to strike between getting our colleagues in China to work with us on things like origins, while at the same time maintaining strong scientific partnership around the things that matter for us all. And I think that's the balance I hope we're striking. It's not very easy, but you and the media are very good at letting us know when we get that balance wrong. So we enjoy the engagement on this.
Thank you, Dr. Ryan. Paula Duprat, and then Laurent and John Zarakos. Paula?
Yes, hi, good afternoon. My name is Paula Duprat. I'm with Geneva Solutions. I have a couple of questions regarding the senior management changes that have taken place at WHO. Why is it that they come at this time? Can we expect changes in strategy or shifts in approaches? How were these decisions taken? From by whom and so forth?
No, thank you. I think a good number of people, first of all, are staying. And so maybe, you know. And then Those who have already left, by the way, they have done everything they could, and my respect and appreciation for all their contribution. Many factors, including some had to retire because of age, others have wanted to leave because they have other things to do. So that always happens. I don't think there is anything special about people who have left. That's something that you expect from in any organization. And the decision, as I said, is based on those factors. I think going forward with the replacement and maybe change in strategy, it's even within when you have the same team, you can still change a strategy. I don't think you need to change people to change strategy necessarily. Of course, that could be the case, but that's not the case here. And in the selection of people, we have a small panel of four people, long list of people who can join WHO, headhunt or recommendation from others. And it's from that very long list through a very intense process. Actually, we have come up with the first two. We announced the first two, as you know, yesterday. Jeremy Farrar as chief scientist, and also Amelia as chief nursing officer. And we will continue to fill also the remaining, I think, three or four posts, not really many. And we will use that panel to select the right people. And we take also gender and geography into consideration, because we believe that talent is universal, opportunity is not. So if we take our time to identify the right people, we can find them from anywhere. Like our chief nursing officer, for instance, is from Tonga. It could be a small country, but you can get talent even in a small country or big country, poor country or rich country. So that's what we're trying to do, the right people, searching throughout the world. So we have a strong team. But again, the last 2-3 years have been very, very difficult. The whole world has been in a serious challenge. And especially WHO was, as they say, in the eye of the storm. And it's the team, those who stayed or those who have already moved into another opportunity, have done their best to really contribute whatever we can to fight this pandemic, and in a very stressful and difficult condition, actually. So my respect and appreciation to colleagues. I always believe that one part of our job should be as leaders. I think even the most important work is how we treat our people, and the reason I'm saying this is our respectful work week, and we're discussing with colleagues, and recognizing all the not only the management but the whole WHO staff who have been under stress for a long time. I think we're trying to ask questions: how do we really give all the necessary support that our colleagues need, all levels, headquarters, region, and country level. But I would like to use this opportunity actually to appreciate not only the leadership, but all our staff for doing all they could under serious stress, including those who have started a new chapter. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Tedros. Laurent, and then John.
Laurent Ciro, Swiss News Agency. Director General, thank you for the briefing. You mentioned the meeting on the future pandemic accord, which took place last week. And even if there will be a draft zero on the table in February, some delegations, including the US, clearly stated that a lot of components are not ripe to really start the negotiations yet. So how confident are you that the targeted deadline for 2024 will be honored? And then briefly, if I may, there was a survey today in Switzerland, released in Switzerland, which shows that the confidence in science, which peaked in 2020 during the first year of the pandemic, has now declined and reached the pre-pandemic level. So how worried are you by that? Thank you.
So I will ask Dr. Mahjour to take the first question.
Yeah, thank you very much for this very important question. And as you know, the intergovernmental negotiation body was established by the last special assembly 1 year ago, and they started working in February. I think they spent the last 9 months is collecting from various stakeholders and from member state ideas what they would like to discuss in this discussion. And the input were mainly coming from the lesson that member state and stakeholders learned from the COVID. And during this collection of ideas, countries and stakeholders also learned from various processes. First, they organized some informal discussion on some specific topic that they think are important. They also asked member states and stakeholders to come up with contribution. And also we organized two public hearings to hear from the public on the importance of treaty. I agreed with you in the beginning, many member states and stakeholders were still thinking about the importance or the opportunity of having such accord to be discussed. Our feeling now after the INB2 in July, where the member state identified the provision under which the discussion and negotiation will start, there is consensus that this accord should be legally binding, negotiated under Article 19 of the Constitution, and also without prejudice to using other article like Article 21 in the Constitution. Our feeling in listening to the member state discussion last two weeks ago in the INB3 is that member states are very serious about this process. They asked the Bureau of the INB to transform the paper that was submitted to them in the first week of December, which is a collection of ideas and input from member state, to real text to start negotiation. All of them, without exception, they are looking forward to this process. The importance of this came from the member state involvement, and there is general agreement that this step, next step in February, it's important to start negotiation. And we feel also strong commitment from member state. They are willing to respect the deadline that they themselves established in coming up with their final outcome in the World Health Assembly in May 24. I think this is our feeling listening to the member state discussion. And maybe if you allow me, Steve Solomon can add. He's our legal officer who is leading the legal part of this process.
Thank you. And with thanks to Dr. Mahjour for this opportunity, maybe I can just complement what he's saying with a few legal considerations. First, the question is, we understood it, is are member states on the same page with respect to the pandemic accord? And the answer is yes and no. Yes, they are on the same page that this will be a legally binding international agreement. It will be, in an international law sense, a treaty, a pandemic treaty, and member states are on the same page that they are working on the basis that this will be a legally binding convention or agreement. As to the limited time, it is true that the deadline is very ambitious. May 2024 is just 18 months away. It is also true that the WHO Constitution, which all 194 member states adhere to, was drafted in 6 months. So there is, in that sense, three times the amount of time that was used to draft this, the WHO Constitution, available to member states. That is still, in an international context, limited time. And it will take political will. to deliver an instrument for the World Health Assembly in May 2024 to consider for adoption. But given the emphasis of member states on the principles that the Director General identified, the principles of equity, in particular equitable access, the principles of solidarity, and the principle of sovereignty, based on these principles, there is clearly member state momentum towards delivering this pandemic accord on time.
So I'll be brief because I know we want to get to more questions, but your second question on trust in science, I think, is a really important one. And it's something that we spend a lot of time here thinking about and trying to address. We are a scientific organization. We're an evidence-based organization. We work with experts around the world. And trust is something that is very hard won and very easily lost. But science is the foundation by which we work. And I know that there are a lot of surveys that are out there that are looking in communities and how they trust leaders, how they trust scientists. For us, we find strength in our comprehensive reach to expertise around the world. In the last couple of years, we have expanded our partnerships. We have expanded the technical partners with which we work, where we work with them, the different disciplines which we bring into the tent to discuss. We welcome debate. We welcome discussion. In fact, some of the best discussions we've ever had are some of the fiercest ones and some of the most critical to us that keep our eyes open to remain humble to the science. But science is a process. Oftentimes we get asked, when can you just have an answer? When can you just be done? Please just give us an answer and then please just don't change it. But that's just not how science works. And to us, this is a strength because this allows us to course correct. This allows us to adjust our strategies, to update that work. And that is something that is really, really critical. But trust is something I've been thinking about a lot in recent months in my travels around the world. And I think this is it's a concerning time right now because there are so many attacks on science itself, on scientists, on public health professionals. And we need scientists to have the space to work responsibly, safely, collaboratively, and transparently. And if they cannot do that, then we cannot do our jobs because we cannot consolidate that data, that knowledge, and turn that knowledge into know-how and that knowledge into how-to. And that is something that we constantly strive for. Sylvie does a lot of work across the world with many different groups, many different partners to inform, to listen, to engage. And that's something that we are committed to. But I think we as an organization, as the World Health Organization with our partners, have to ensure that space so that scientists have that work to do. So those surveys are helpful for us to know, to listen. But I think we have a lot more work to do. And I don't know if Sylvie wants to comment on the further engagement that we have with the different communities around the world.
Yeah, thank you very much. Yes, briefly, I think this kind of survey is very important because as Maria said, trust in science is extremely important in pandemic response because it will really influence the compliance of population to the intervention. If scientists can show that there is evidence that, for example, wearing masks is effective to prevent transmission, then the population, if they trust science, they will also apply and use masks when it's recommended. So I think the trust in science is important. And unfortunately, what we have seen during crisis in the past is that sometimes the trust in science or the trust in health authorities or in government may decrease during crisis because crises are very specific time in the life of a society. And so this is a time where certain fundamental things like trust can be undermined and can be shaken very heavily. So it's very important. That's why we recommend to country to work on this trust issue and to and there are ways also to maintain trust or to increase trust in science by having this dialogue with population, explaining how science works. That is a process that and also especially during pandemic we have seen that many things have changed. The virus has changed, the knowledge we have on the virus has increased, and so that's why strategies have been adapted along the line. So it's very important also to convey those messages and be in line with the concerns of the population, because very often they ask relevant questions. And so we need to answer those questions in a timely manner to maintain the trust in the science. Thank you.
And can I just add one sentence? Despite all of that, it really doesn't help to build trust in science or safety for scientists when powerful individuals, be they politicians or billionaires, expose those scientists time and time again with their very ill-chosen words and comments.
Thank you. I think I will take one or two more questions for us to have time gather outside for a very light refreshment with DG and our experts. So I think it was John, and then our friend from Yumiuri, Satoko. John and then Satoko. No, it's okay. So it will be Antonio. Antonio then. John and Antonio. Antonio, go ahead.
Thank you, Fadela. So as the WHO and international community is discussing a treaty to prevent future pandemics, I would like to ask, how do you think these next future pandemics may look like? If they could be as lethal as COVID, if yet another coronavirus is the main candidate to provoke them, but also if it's possible that COVID becomes the last pandemic. Thank you.
Okay, so I start, and I think Mike will continue, but thanks a lot for this question. I think everybody wonder, okay, how can we, what is the future, and can we predict the next pandemic? So unfortunately, we cannot predict what will come next, because nature is unpredictable. And we have seen, for example, if you take the issue of monkeypox, we have been monitoring this disease for many years, and it was localized for many years, and suddenly went out of the box, and we have had many countries affected at once. So I think this is the lessons that we can learn from nature. However, I think it's very important to get prepared for the next pandemic, and there are ways to get better prepared. And this is why at WHO we have conducted some foresight exercise. We brought together a variety of stakeholders from civil society, from scientific and academic settings, from different sectors as well, public health, but also agriculture and animal health sectors, and many, many different sectors, private sectors, etc., to imagine what could be the future and define different scenarios that could happen in the future. And so, of course, imagining the future may think a bit light, but it's very important that we have a common view at the future. And those foresight exercises have helped us enormously, first to try to understand what could be the risk in the future, especially at the time where we are living in the fourth revolution, technological revolution. So there are many innovation, many new things that are happening in health and elsewhere. So how do we integrate those innovation in the way we see the future? And then trying also to prioritize the risk and bring also the risk in packages. And for instance, we recommend now to countries to understand in the millions of viruses that are out there. Some of them are transmissive, respiratory transmission, so we can get ready for this kind of event. Others are transmitted by vectors, so we can put in place measures to be able to deal with vector transmission. Some others are transmitted by water, so how we can secure a water supply, etc. So really having a preparedness that is guided by scenarios, and also increased collaboration between different sectors to make sure that we are all together to face the next pandemic.
I mean, just remind you that, you know, we're still in the seventh pandemic of cholera. It was mentioned by the DG before. So before we worry too much about the foresight for what might come new, we're still in this one and COVID, and we're still 50 years on. struggling to contain a perfectly preventable disease, because all we have to do is give people clean water, access to basic sanitation, and in some cases a cholera vaccine, and that disease goes away. Someone once said to me, if the cure to world disease was a single glass of clean water for every person living on this planet, we wouldn't be able to achieve it. So I think the issue is not technology. The issue is the will. The issue is really, and Tedros speaks to this all the time. It's about, you said it in your introduction. I think I was reflecting on your very nice introduction. And I think when I think the same thing, he comes to mind as well. I'm also interested in foresight from the perspective of the game that's going to happen later. I'm reminded that Sylvie is from France and Jaouad here beside me is from Morocco. So wishing those two teams the best of luck later, and the fact that in WHO we have a huge interest in that. Two of my dearest colleagues are from opposite sides of that battle tonight, so good luck to both.
So maybe just to add to that, I think the key is not predicting. To be honest, I can assume the worst could happen. So the key is, how do we prepare for any eventualities? And that's why we're investing in preparedness. And there are many things that are now moving, there are many moving parts. As you know, the treaty which we have been discussing about, based on the principles of equity, solidarity, and also sovereignty, of course. But equity and solidarity is what we have been calling for even during this pandemic. If the content of this accord is really good enough and something that can address the many challenges we have faced during this pandemic through a serious learning, then that's the part of the preparation. Of course, accord doesn't help. We need to move into putting everything together, implement all the recommendations. But not only the accord or the treaty, as you know, pandemic fund has already been established. And of course, it's on a pilot basis, but we have the universal health and preparedness review that some countries have already joined. And learning on share, in order to speed up sharing of pathogens, we have the biohub now installed, and learning from how we can do better in surveillance, we have the pandemic intelligence or the collective intelligence at Berlin, the Berlin hub. And then I can go on and on, like the mRNA hub, for instance, in South Africa, and the training center, especially for bio, for the Korean center now. So there are many things that are being already done. So it will depend on how well we really prepare the world. As we speak, we're not yet prepared. The world is not yet prepared for the worst. But if we seriously learn from this and do everything to address the challenges that we have faced, then the future will be better. So it's by our actions, actually, we define how fair or unfair the future will be for us. Are we fair or unfair on what, can we learn? And are we really fair on ourselves? Meaning, do we want to do everything to protect us, to invest in security? Then I think that will bring a better future. So I wouldn't focus on prediction. You can predict the worst, and the best is to prepare for it. And I see some encouraging signs, and that's what we should continue to push. And on the accord or treaty, whether we will have it by May 2024, I think we can, because what I have seen so far, countries are actually delivering on what they have promised. There was a lot of concern from us, from our side, and many others, that there may not be agreement on a, you know, to have a legally binding accord. But they have already settled that. And of course, the basic principles are also there, which they have already agreed. Of course, at the end of the day, it will be the content which will define whether we will have a good treaty or not. But I hope, since we have learned from this pandemic the hard way, and I don't think anyone would like a repeat of this or something even worse. I hope that's how the world will continue, learn from this and prepare for the future. So thank you, Fadila, and back to you.
I think with this DG words, we can close this press conference, unless John, last question, and maybe Tomo, but briefly. Okay, John.
Yes, good afternoon. Dr. Tedros, I'd like your thoughts on why humanitarian emergency aid is continuing to be underfunded, especially in your area, health. And secondly, on the issue of the pandemic treaty, we heard about progress on equity solidarity in the preparations here in the WHO, but down the road in the WTO, they kicked that into the lake on the extension to therapeutics and diagnostics. So there seems to be a disconnect on two sides of the same issue in this city. If you could elaborate a little bit.
Would you like to start?
I can have a go at the first one, John. I haven't got the numbers in front of me, but
51.5 is the ask for next year for the global appeal.
I think there's a number of issues. When you say the word humanitarian, there's development, there's humanitarian in terms of acute response, there's the funding to build better healthcare systems and avoid the worst impacts of disasters, and there are different funding streams. And look, we are grateful to those donors and those countries who continue to invest and respond by providing funds to the contingency fund for emergencies, respond to our appeals for funding for the health component of humanitarian response as part of humanitarian appeals, who continue to resource the COVID response, who resource, and those who are least thanked in public, the ones who resource preparedness initiatives and training initiatives and initiatives to build better lab networks, or to build stronger immunization systems. We're grateful. But the reality is that pie is now, you know, very finite, and in some cases is contracting because of policy decisions. Governments are under pressure themselves, and I certainly, none of us here, Tedros will speak to this, I don't want to be successful at raising money for the humanitarian or the emergency sphere if I take funding away from Kate's work in getting vaccination levels high, or someone else's work in creating access to TB drugs, or whatever it might be. So there is that problem, and we've got the development pot and the humanitarian pot. I honestly believe if we think that we're just going to take the money to do preparedness for the next pandemic out of that pot, then we can do only damage. We have to ask ourselves the question, where strategically does the bulk of the funding need to come to make the world secure against epidemics and pandemics? Is that a health spend, or is that a security spend? Is that a spend in our defense of the health of our population? So there are large questions, John, around where this money is sourced. We have no problem purchasing 10 years in advance a carrier group, aircraft carrier with its support ships, costs somewhere between, I think, $30 and $40 billion. There's absolutely no problem whatsoever in making that decision 10 years in advance for a theater of operations that's only part of a foresight exercise, some long-term planning exercise, no problem. And if those particular platforms of war are not used or are never used in anger, we declare success. We say the world is a safer place, that a shot was fired in anger because we built these platforms. We do not apply the same principle when it comes to protecting health and securing not our borders, but securing the health and welfare of our populations against just as insidious a threat as might exist from a mortal enemy. And I think that's the question we need to be asking, John. It's not how can I do better against other agencies in raising money, because that sort of negative competition kills everyone. I do think that there's an appropriate, and I think for the first time ever, an appropriate level of outrage and funding going in to support the people of Ukraine. But one of the paradoxical side effects of that is that it's harder and harder to raise adequate funds in other areas right now. That is no criticism of spending money in saving and supporting the lives of the people of Ukraine. But our outrage, appropriate as it is in Ukraine, has drowned out the screams and cries of suffering in many cases around the world in other crises. So I think from our perspective, we continue to really thank those donors, particularly those who stayed in the game, those who continue to support the work we do. We would like to see more people come into that. And we tend to go back to the same group, the same small number of countries who are in that process. And they often get a lot of criticism for not giving enough. I'll ask the question, there are many other countries out there that are rarely giving anything. And I do think we need to look at the spread of the burden of humanitarian response financially across the breadth of member states that we have. I would hope that we, and Tedros mentioned the pandemic fund, and I would hope through innovative mechanisms like that, that we can find ways to fund this process. The G20 initiative between the finance and health ministers, which it's interesting that, going back to pre-pandemic, and I'll just tell a very short story because I think it's important. In the months before the pandemic, Dr. Tedros was extremely concerned with the likelihood and the growing risks of a pandemic. In fact, I think you had wrote to and engaged with the Secretary General. Yeah, he had wanted to have a summit in 2020 on the threat of pandemics. And one of those initiatives was to generate a meeting between health and finance ministers, which was scheduled for Marrakesh in the first quarter of 2020. Because at that point, he felt we did not have the right finance in pandemic preparedness to actually do the job. History tells the tale of what happened. So the fact that working with the G20, Tedros has managed to get that process of the G20 and health ministers together in a permanent group with the secretariat based here in Geneva, in which we will continue the conversation between the people who have the money and the people who need to get the money to spend on health, I think is a huge step forward. It doesn't guarantee success, but the right conversations are happening with the right people. And in my memory, that's the first time that's happened in the space we're in a permanent way that's going to continue. Tedros may wish to comment on that. But we're going in the right direction. But we have to get into the development funds, the multilateral funds, John, the IDA 20, into the development banks. We've got to put pandemics and public health and health systems at the center of the investment case for societies. Not just economic development, but health systems development as a central pillar of prosperity and stability in a future world. And I think if we do that, and we also speak to our defense colleagues and make the case that protecting biosecurity, the ability for us to defend ourselves against pathogens, natural and otherwise, is mainly delivered through the health system. It's mainly delivered through the public health system. That defense is not delivered through military prevention or intervention. It's delivered through civilian systems. And we need to be sure that the resources are there to be able to do that. Tedros.
Okay, the resources are there. So the main question is, does the world have money? And the answer is yes. I was reading an article on military expenditure. It's expected to cross $2 trillion a year this year. It may cross the line. It will be above $2 trillion. That's what's expected. So there is money. And then the other way you would know there is money is when COVID hit, many countries invested lots of money and lost a lot also, trillions. So there is money. So the issue is there a commitment to invest money? Why do we even, as Mike said, compete between the regular, like vaccination, and then putting money for emergency? I think if there is a will, there is a way. If there is commitment, the money is there. It's a matter of putting it on the table. Otherwise, imagine $2 trillion US dollars a year global expenditure to kill people. So to kill people, to kill each other, and then no investment to save each other. So the world should come back to its senses. But there is money. And we have seen it during this COVID when money was flowing, cash was flowing. But why do we put money when there is this fear? Why not we prepare, as Antonio asked, actually, based on what the future holds for us? And the future is not holding good for us if we don't prepare. We define the world, the future, actually. So I think there is enough money, not enough commitment. That's what we believe. And with commitment, I think this could be addressed. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Tedros. Dr. Mahjour, you wanted to answer those questions.
Yeah, and just to confirm that from the discussion in the INB3 and before, there is strong commitment of member state to put equity at the center of any accord. The member state don't expect equity only as provision of an accord, but they expect that equity is an outcome of the accord and also an indicator to measure the implementation of the accord. Equity at the center, but when member state look to equity, they don't look it in very narrow angle. They look at it cross-cutting in all areas. If you are familiar with the conceptual draft that member state discussed last week, there is a proposed 12 substantive element of the future accord, and member state sees the equity in each one of them. There is commitment, and this general comment, no single member state is against the importance of equity, because this is what came very obvious from the lesson we learned from the COVID. On the relationship with other instrument, maybe Steve is the best one to respond to it.
Yes, thanks very much, Dr. Mahjour. So John, to your question about whether specifically, I think, IP issues have been, I think you used a very colorful phrase, thrown into the lake. As Dr. Mahjour said, in the INB, nothing has been taken off the table. You'll see that these issues are all dealt with in the conceptual zero draft. That's a 36-page document, and the principle that is operative for producing the zero draft by the officers of the group, the principle is that no idea will be deleted. That means that IP issues, in addition to many other issues, will all be considered when the intergovernmental negotiating body next meets at the end of February. That's where the negotiations begin. And that's where all member states are not yet on the same page. That wouldn't be something we'd expect at this point. But the purpose of negotiations on every issue, including the sensitive ones, is to identify differences, find solutions to those differences, bridge gaps that exist, and ultimately find and forge consensus among all 194 member states. And they have six officers that they have elected, one from each of the WHO regions, which will help in leading them in that effort to find consensus on all of these issues. Thank you.
I think it's time for us to close this press conference, even if I know we have one or two journalists willing to ask more questions. So you are welcome to join Dr. Tedros for a small gathering outside. Thanking you for your presence. And Dr. Tedros, you have...
Thank you. No, thank you. So we, not just one, Tamer, thank you for your kind words, but would be happy to propose maybe quarterly for you only. So instead of once a year, huh? Yeah, and it was nice actually meeting you today. I was hesitating to cancel the press conference because it was a bit difficult moment for me because I was informed, but I know you would you would not have been happy if we canceled it. I was struggling, but we went ahead because on last Saturday, I was informed that my uncle was murdered by Eritrean army. And I spoke to my mother and she was really devastated because he was the youngest from their family and he was almost same age with me, young uncle. So I was not in good shape, that's why. But good I met you, actually. And I hope the peace agreement will hold and this madness would stop. But it just a very, very difficult moment for me. And he was not alone, by the way. In the village, when they killed him in his home from same village, more than 50 people were killed, just arbitrary. So that was why, but at least I'm glad I met you and
thank you very much and I was solidarity with you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you.